Lone Star Drift Tech Tip. We're here at round 5 of Lone Star Drift down in Houston, Texas. And say you have a V8 car, or any car, but say a V8 car, and you have a supercharger maybe, but maybe just a V8, and lots of our cars here run hot in the summer. So you get yourself a big radiator, and the car still runs hot. So then you get yourself a big fancy electric fan with cool shrouding, and it still runs hot. And then you remember that trick that we do sometimes in stockish drift cars, where we turn the heat on full blast. And basically that's a heater core, which is like a little tiny radiator for the engine that lets air flow through it into the cabin and bake you kind of thing. And that gets some of the heat out of the engine because that's coolant running through the heater core system and running heat through the car. So that might help bring the temperature of the car down some. But to like take that to the next level, look at this, Si. Normally in race car LS1 stuff, we have these two water lines here and these go to the heater core. You kind of have to get over here a little bit. So the line's down there and typically we loop that line and then there's just a quick, like it simplifies the engine bay, right? So you loop that, simplifies the engine bay and all your cooling is done up here and you don't have a heater core anymore. Well, they took it to the next level and this line now goes all the way to the back of the car.
I just see it here.
Yeah, it should all be shielded so you can't like get sprayed by it and there's an occupant and stuff because you can't run the stuff inside the car. But then they run a second radiator in the back with fans on it, a whole radiator, and hopefully this keeps the car completely cool. Now it works on the same premise as like the heater core thing, and I never thought about like why don't you just run two radiators? That's even simpler than just running a rear mount or you know a front mount or whatever you want to do. Does it work well?
Works great. I haven't run 200 degrees.
So normally what do you get up to out here? 220, 230?
No, not 220, 230.
We all know that LS1s run really hot. Like it's known that Corvettes and stuff in traffic will do 220, 240. Like just sitting there, they get really, really hot. So the fact that this thing is staying underneath 200 out here, it's really not that bad, but it's really humid. It's like 92 or something maybe today. So it is hot today and it's running super cool. And this is a high horsepower, like 600 wheel supercharged V8. And this is just very interesting. You never see dual radiators. And realistically a radiator, how much does this radiator weigh? Not much.
Nothing, maybe 5-10 pounds.
And then filling it with water, it's only an extra few gallons of coolant, which is 8.5 pounds per gallon of coolant, I think. So you're probably looking at 10 pounds for radiator and stuff, another 20 for the coolant or something like that. I'm not sure what it is, but probably only like 35 extra pounds. And the whole car to not have heating issues. And it's in the back of the car, which is kind of a good place to put weight. So anyways, it's just kind of a unique thing. You don't see a lot of ducting on the car, so it doesn't have huge air intake ducting. It's just air being drawn in naturally from the back here and that. And what's interesting, look at this. They're drawing air through that way. So is it push or pull?
It's pull, so it's pulling air through.
So it's pulling air from up here, from a fired walled area, and it has to come from underneath the car, get pulled there, and get exhausted.
Damn.
Probably just runs into a dead wall here, and has to be pushed down.
We're gonna cut all this out, put mesh and everything, kind of like mess her in on this remote.
So right now, it's not even, not to like say anything bad, but like it's not a well thought out airflow pattern, but it still works. So typically when people do rear mount radiators, they duct things, they really try and focus the airflow. So he's not even doing that, he's just having another radiator back here. When you open the trunk, is it super hot in here?
A little bit. I mean, it's keeping a lot of heat from the cabin. Most of the heat's contained back here.
Cool. All right. That was a tech tip from Lone Star Drift. Run two radiators if your car is overheating.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Cool. All right. Get back to driving. For the last 30 seconds of this clip, let's just like go over his car. It is a wide body S13. It has that KBD body kit life with the flexible body kit. So all this is flexible, it's not fiberglass. You can run over as many times as you want. He does not have a passenger seat. Whoa, okay, he's got fiberglass doors too. It's very nicely put together car where it's nicely painted, it's all nicely clean. It looks like it's a T56 or TR6060 or something with a racing seat, steering wheel, stock dash. And then a supercharged V8 in here. Is it LS1, LS2, LS3?
LS6.
LS6, that's the highest of the numbers before you get to the LS7. Big supercharger, and then obviously tube frame front end. Looks like he has GK Tech arms.
Yeah.
Very cool.
GK Tech front and rear now. And the car feels great.
How fast is the car?
Pretty fast.
Real fast?
Super fast in drifting.
Yeah. Was it scary fast at Texas Motor Speedway, or was it controllable the entire time?
I didn't have a set alignment on it. Uh-huh. It was still on just an eyeball, especially on the rear, so a lot of stuff wasn't set. It still felt really fast, especially in drift. I was running 35 PSI on the back, and
it's
still gripping up insane.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like right now I'm running 30, and the track feels great.
Yeah.
I've always been running 12, 10 PSI just to get grip out of the car, and now it's actually gripping up mechanically.
How did you add mechanical grip to it?
The drop knuckles in the rear, mm-hmm. and just doing the alignment. I did it with Rudy.
Cool.
Dexter.
Awesome.
They helped me out over there.
All right, now go drive. All right, sorry, let's go look at something else to do.